Talk 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 Show. Hello, hello, hello. It's the Chitty Petty Bubble Talk Talk Show.
We will talk about the things that mean so much to you, like going to a restaurant or hanging at the zoo, clothes and sports and funny news, crafts and travel too. Nothing ever scripted, so expect the unexpected.
Hello, hello, hello. It's the Chitty Petty Bubble Talk Talk Show. It's the Chitty Petty Bubble Talk Talk Show.
Hi, welcome to our show. It's Tuesday, November 17th, and we have a special guest today. It's Bob Mueller from the Royal Oak Nature Society. Welcome, Bob.
I love nature.
Yeah, but first we're going to talk about some announcements I have and get those out of the way. The Troy Chamber of Commerce had their annual Simply Shopping event at Somerset Mall. I was lucky enough to attend. Over 175 shoppers showed up, and it's a special deal where you pay a little bit of money, and then you get, as a Troy Chamber of Commerce money, you get coupons and discounts throughout the mall. You get free breakfast, and people find you throughout the mall and take your bags for you, so you don't have to carry them around. It was a lot of fun, and thank you to the Troy Chamber of Commerce for that. Another big announcement is at the Stagecrafters in Royal Oak is Mary Poppins.
Wow.
We had on Marianne McCourt from Stagecrafters. Have you been to any shows at Stagecrafters?
I've got season tickets for Stagecrafters.
You do? So you'll be at Mary Poppins.
Yes, I will.
That's going to be a great one. It's running through December 20th at the Baldwin Theater in Royal Oak. So I love Stagecrafters. I'm sure it's going to be a great show. Okay, and CMNtv is friends with OLSA, the Oakland Livingston Housing, oh gosh, now I can't remember what it all stands for, OLSA. Anyway, they're having a homeowners assistance clinic on Friday, December 4th at New Bethel Missionary Baptist Church. So it's about property taxes and mortgage payments. If you know someone struggling with that, OLSA can definitely help. It's OLHSA.org. And one more item. At Troy High School, there's going to be an Elf Shelf Arts and Crafts Show. It's the 44th annual juried show held by the Troy Women's Association. So once again, this is at Troy High School on, November 28th, the Saturday after Thanksgiving, and another opportunity to do some shopping for the Christmas or Hanukkah or whatever you need gifts for. That'll be a great event.
Will someone come and get your bags for you then?
No, I don't think so. Okay. That was a fancy thing at Somerset.
That's very fancy.
But back to the Royal Oak Nature Society and Bob Mueller. So you've been a Royal Oak resident almost your whole life.
Actually, my entire life.
Okay.
Yes.
I was
born in Pleasant Ridge. Before the sun went down, I was in my parents' home. So I figure that means every day of my life I was a resident.
That's great. Well, what do you like about Royal Oak?
I think it's always been a great city. It's almost a small town, even though it's a large city. I mean, when I was in high school, I think it was the 10th largest city in the state. I'm sure it isn't today. But nevertheless, you know, that's a pretty good-sized community. But there's this feeling, and there's so many people involved in different things in the city.
Like Paula and me.
Yeah.
Our show.
Yeah. And so I think it's just a very nice place to live, nice place to raise your kids.
And the parks, we're really lucky to have so many great parks.
Well, I think there's 53, if I remember right. So
really?
Not many cities have that many parks. So we're really lucky that that occurred.
Well, tell us about the wooded areas. How many woods do we have?
We have two nature parks, Cummingston, which is over near Myers. If you drive down Myers Drive, you see the back of it. And Tenhave Woods, which is behind the high school. And Tenhave Woods is the remnant of a woodlot from an original settler's farm who came here in 1823. And we know it's never been clear cut because a lot of the plants that are there are shade needing plants. So they may have cut some trees occasionally for lumber or whatever, but they never got rid of all the shade.
It's so beautiful when you're at a sporting event at Royal Oak High School, sitting in the bleachers, and the backdrop of the woods behind the field is so beautiful. We're so lucky to have that area. So you're saying that the soil is basically untouched?
Pretty close, yes. And we've identified over 300 different flowering plants, which makes it a pretty rich woods for being in the city. Actually, the gentleman who bought the land from the United States of America in 1823.
Wow.
Yeah, which
and
most
of us... And
do you know
his name? Is his name Tenhave?
Cromwell Goodwin. No, Tenhave was a teacher at the high school.
Oh, right, right.
We were wondering what Tenhave meant.
And it stayed in the family until 1905 when the grandson's widow sold the land to finish raising the kids. But if you, his son, Samuel, if you sat on Crooks and looked at the high school campus and the woods behind it, you're seeing what was a 100-acre farm in the late 1800s.
Wow.
And without all the houses on it, you can get a feel for how big it is.
Yeah. Have you ever found any structures in there? Are there any remnants of a structure?
No, there's a small, maybe 4-foot square footings for a shed or something, concrete, that are old, but
outhouse.
We have no idea. Could be, could have been. And we actually dug in the center of it a little bit and sort of sifted the dirt to see if maybe something showed up. And it was simply a lot of work and broken glass showed up. So, you know,
some old pottery from the 1800s.
Yeah, right. We didn't get anything good like that. It was just normal, you know, Coke bottle caps and broken glass
from
bottles.
Kids. That,
probably because it was a good place to break the bottle on the cement that was there. But most of it is just...
Those darn kids.
It was sort of swampy land, so I think when they cleared for fields, they got to the back of their property, it was a little swampy. And back then, you had to have a wood lot. I mean, that's where the fuel to heat your house came from, the wood to build your barn and your house and your fences. And it just managed to never be developed, which is lucky for us.
Wow, that's amazing. So tell us a little bit more about what goes on at the woods, because you would think that it's just quiet and nothing happens back there. But I know like a tree branch will fall and damage the fence, and then creatures will get in and creatures will get out.
Have you seen this happen? I mean, how do you know this?
Because I drive by it and I see a branch on the fence.
And you see animals like pouring in
No, but I figured that must be how they get in and out.
Because there are deer in there, which I'm wondering.
Well, not anymore, thank goodness.
Yeah, they flushed them out.
The deer were too many. They were going to browse it to non-existence in a matter of a year.
Oh.
And about 3 years ago, we spent $14,000 and 600 man hours of labor to redo the fence high enough the deer couldn't jump over it. And then we got unlucky because two does crawled under the fence. We weren't thinking about it, didn't touch the ground in places. And 6 inches is all a deer needs to crawl under a fence.
They really like it in there. Yeah. They wanted to go back.
Yeah, and so those deer, those two does had
two
fawns each. So now we had, you know, four babies.
So it
begins.
In
the fall, the moms left, but the babies didn't. And then the next year, we were unlucky enough that of the four, one was a buck, three were does, so we now had seven deer. And last winter, we managed to open the gates, and they wandered out. And while they were out, we closed the gates.
And now they're living on Hendry.
Yeah, well, they're actually, deer are all through Metro Detroit, all the way to the river. So it's not just here. There's an awful lot of them in Oakview Cemetery.
They're sneaky.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And these are urban deer. I mean, you don't see a lot of them dead on the roads like you do out in the country, where the headlights, you know, freak them out. Someone got a photo of a 10-point buck at Lincoln and Campbell 3 years ago. So it isn't just where there's a woody area. It means they can just live in the neighborhoods and hide in the day and come out at night.
Now, that particular neighborhood, I know everybody has a fenced-in backyard, so I don't know how they get around, because sometimes I can see animals are just stuck going straight down the street because everybody has a fenced-in backyard.
Yeah. It takes an 8-foot fence to stop a deer. So
a 4-foot
fence is like
so
us stepping.
So they can jump that 7 feet?
Yeah, they can go over a 6-foot fence like it's not there.
Oh, my gosh.
And they walk up to it. They jump like a cat. They're almost straight up.
I'm going to go raise my fence.
Yeah, so 4-foot fences, to a deer, that's like us stepping over the curb. You know, it's like not a trick at all.
I feel sorry for them because they're not meant to live in neighborhoods, but
no.
They're surviving.
They're eating the food at a Tenhave Woods, right?
Yeah.
Because there's must be a lot of nutrients in there.
Well, for the first few years we had a few deer, we didn't have a problem because they liked hostas better than they liked what was in the woods. But as soon as they ate all the neighbors' plants, then they were eating our trilliums and things. So, you know, we had to do something. But we've got coyotes in Royal Oak, we've got fox in Royal Oak, we've got raccoons, we've got possums, we've got skunks. When I was a kid, we had squirrels. So all of these things have moved into the city since I was a kid. And we do know that at one point we had a neighbor across Normandy call us and tell us that 100 raccoons come out of the woods single file every night. And we thought, right.
And so out of Tenhave Woods?
Out of Tenhave. And so he said, come over at dusk and look. And we drove over and we could actually see a path that went through the grass and across the street and through this guy's yard.
Did they split up, or do they all
go
to the same garbage can?
They were going, well, we found out later that there was some lady somewhere in Clawson that was putting out like 30 or 40 pounds of cracked corn a night. So obviously they knew where they were going.
Attracting the They are cute though.
Stop that.
Really cute. That many is sort of a problem.
Yeah, that's a gang. That's a gang.
Yeah, so there's a lot of wildlife. Flying squirrels are real common in Royal Oak, and nobody ever sees them because, you know, they're this big and they're flying around from tree to tree in the dark 50 feet in the air, which means since we don't see in the dark, we don't see them.
But I have a groundhog. Our neighborhood has a groundhog community.
And
Lincoln and Knowles. Yeah, there's a groundhog in my yard.
Well,
and,
I don't live far from you then, so you got a lot of groundhogs there.
Well, the people across the street told us that they have a groundhog too, and I've seen two at one time. So I really am curious. I don't know where their path leads to underground.
They have burrows. Yeah,
he has a 3-point system in our yard. He has three holes. So he can get around my yard very easily.
Imagine what's under there, all the tunnels.
I have no idea what's under there. That's kind of scary.
And I see a lot of hawks, too.
A hawk watcher. I feel like there are less hawks this year than there were in the past couple of years from what I've witnessed. What are your thoughts?
And why? Why are there less?
Actually, that was another bird that when I was a kid, we didn't see any hawks, and now they're, you know, pretty common. We generally have two types here. We have,
the red-tailed.
Red-tailed and Cooper's. Cooper's, which is a bird hawk. It's catching songbirds on the wing. Where the red-tailed hawk is the guy that's getting chipmunks and mice or
squirrels.
Rats. Or squirrels, yeah.
And I have red squirrels, too. We didn't have them, but they're new to my property in the just past couple of years.
They're fast.
They're mean, too.
They're mean.
They're the red squirrels are the big one for eating birds' eggs out of the nests and baby birds.
That's why they're mean.
So a lot of people that are really into bird watching generally aren't big fans of red squirrels.
My kitty knows. She wants to get that red squirrel. She's outside. She's watching it like this, just waiting.
My dog wants to get a chipmunk, and she's been known to trap them in the gutter and wait. And she ripped a gutter down once, and it was like, really? That's a lot of work for nothing.
So tell us about being a Boy Scout, a Boy Scoutmaster.
Yeah, well, I was...
For 30 years.
Yeah, I got into scouting as a boy because all I ever wanted to do was get out in the woods. And as a kid, you can't get someplace unless adults put you in a car and drive you. So scouting was the, every month I get to go somewhere out in the woods and hang out. And I just never stopped enjoying it. So at 18, I became an assistant. And when I was about 24, I became a scoutmaster. And I kept doing that for 30 years. I really stopped doing it because of being a naturalist in the parks. It was hard to do both jobs. And there were plenty of other people that could do my scoutmaster job that I was actually holding back from, you know, getting the title or getting awards and that kind
of
thing.
Plus you were stuck doing the Pinewood Derby every year.
Yeah, but I was still having fun. So, you know, there were people that did look at me and go, oh, that's wonderful that you're doing that. And I'm going, I'm just having a good time.
Uh-huh.
You know, which... I'm sure anybody who volunteers in any organization probably is having a really good time or they wouldn't be doing it.
What was your favorite scouting activity?
Camping.
Camping?
Still was. Uh-huh. It was like, even when I could drive myself out into the country, it was like to get to go camping and sleep in a tent or without a tent out in the woods was
without
still something
a tent?
I did. Oh, yeah, we used to sleep out, especially in the winter.
Without a tent in the winter, you're kidding.
Real good chance it won't rain on you in December and January and February.
Oh, man, that's cold, though.
So, yeah, well, I'm not
Was
a
your
hot
head
person.
In the sleeping bag?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Although when you're a kid, it's easier because, you know, a little kid can sort of get in the fetal position or slip down. And adults, if you do that, you know, you'll be in so much pain.
The next morning,
two,
you won't be able to get out.
Yeah, that you can't do it.
You
so,
can't
you know,
get
it's
out
like,
of the sleeping bag.
Yeah. So it was easier, actually, as a kid to keep warm. You could just slide down in there.
Tell us some of the different nature walks that you've led and what's your favorite?
Well, most of the walks we lead in, and the Nature Society has at least one walk a month. Sometimes we have four. Depending on what, like in the fall color, we'll have one every week in October. In April, May, we'll have one every week when all the wildflowers are out. And most of the rest of the year, there might be, you know, one a month. A lot of them are general. We're just talking about what's in the woods, the different trees, the plants, what's happening. Obviously, in the wildflower season, you're talking about what's blooming and what's coming up and what might be blooming next week. Fall color, you're talking about that. We have some pond life programs where I get in the water and catch a lot of the creepy crawlers, and we've got a table with viewing pans.
Okay, where's the water?
Oh,
we have a pond in there, a vernal pond. Vernal ponds are ponds that tend to dry up.
Oh, I thought that was the name of the pond.
No, vernal is actually, I think, spring in Latin. So it's a spring pond, you know, goes away in summer. Or at least gets shallow enough that fish can't live in it. So what happens is, since they're a major predator, it's a great place if you're a dragonfly or a toad or a frog to have your babies because there aren't fish to eat you.
Oh.
So it's a real valuable, a lot of people look at vernal ponds as like waste places, but they're really important to wildlife because you've eliminated that major predator.
Is that why I find frogs in my yard in the spring? Do I have a vernal pond?
You must, because I've never
seen frogs. If you're at Lincoln and Knowles, you're close to where I live, and there haven't been, I'm starting to see toads again, and I'm having them breed in a fish pond in my backyard. So,
but does that make a difference too? Because people are putting ponds in their backyard. That probably
they throw frogs in there.
And then they've refound a place to breed. Because that's it. They have to have quality water. In fact, we reestablished the pond in Tenhave because it had grown up with trees from what it had been in the 70s when I was first involved in that park. And if there's a lot of leaf litter, it takes all the oxygen out of the water. And all these things breathe with gills.
So do you clean the leaves out?
No, what we did is we had to cut a lot of trees down to make it sunny. And the very next year we had all this. Because all we had when there was leaves in it was mosquitoes, which isn't a favorite wildlife of most people.
No.
Nobody would want to go on a nature walk.
Yeah, no, I've never offered a mosquito walk because I don't think anybody would come.
Count mosquitoes.
Yeah, but they'll come and see the dragonflies and the damselflies and the water beetles and those kind of things.
Back to the frogs. Where do frogs go in the winter?
They actually bury themselves in the mud underwater and can breathe, get enough O2 through their skin.
Do they go like dormant, or they just lay
there? Yep, they're dormant. Turtles do the same. And turtles have lungs, and frogs have lungs, but it's amazing they can be underwater for 3 months and absorb enough oxygen right through the skin.
They are superior to humans to be able to survive like that.
Tough little guys.
Really?
Now, when you were growing up and playing outside, was that on the south side of town? Was it woodsy in that neighborhood?
I basically grew up sort of 11 Mile in Campbell, in that general area. And by the time I could walk to Gardenia in Campbell, I could catch garter snakes and crayfish and frogs and toads. And obviously today I'd have to walk, I'm almost to Rochester, probably to do the
to
same
do
thing. Yeah, you know, so, which I guess tells how old I am. You know, it's like, I have fun with kids on nature walks sometimes because I can look at them now and I can say, you know, over half a century ago, I remember. Which will really actually open eyes on little kids. It's like, you know, but yeah, so we're talking, I was a kid in the 50s and early 60s. So that's a ways back now. But I'd mentioned before we talked that Royal Oak was the edge of the suburbs, the northern edge then. There were farms where Oakland Mall is.
Wow.
And
you remember that?
My wife used to ride horses somewhere near Oakland Mall, which does make it sound much older now.
You can still do that for a quarter in the mall.
Yeah. That's the only way you do it today. But I think a few years ago they listed I-75 and 696 as the center of the population of Metro Detroit. So between 1960 and now, we went from the edge to the dead center.
Wow.
So yeah, there's a whole lot less country. There were lots of vacant lots, little pieces of woods that now have houses or businesses on them. They hadn't been developed yet.
Right.
All that's left is their two nature parks. They're still there. But, you know, I wouldn't have had to walk the 3 miles to Tenhave. I could just walk a half mile from my house and be in the woods.
So what about Cummingston Park? Is there anything glamorous going on in there?
It's our bigger problem park for years. It was saved because of three Royal Oak school teachers back in the 50s who had wildflower collections and were sort of in competition. And again, there was places you could just go dig wildflowers up in Royal Oak because they were undeveloped land. It was perfectly okay.
Like you're talking, I would call
a
perennial.
Yeah.
Something for my garden that would come back every year.
Yeah, we
go to English Gardens and buy them, yeah.
But one of these guys discovered the area where Cummingston is and told the city, because it was one of the finest wildflower areas in southeastern Michigan, not the city. And they made it into a park, specifically a wildflower park, and then as development happened around it, nobody paid attention to drainage. It flooded the park and killed all the wildflowers.
Oh,
yeah,
of
so
course.
It's
the city of Troy did that.
No, I'm sorry. Myers Drive was the nail in the casket, you know, but because we're right on the edge there, Troy's across the street. So today we don't have the variety there we have in Tenhave, and so we've put most of our time into bringing the trails up to par and so forth. But lately we now have a lady, Mary Fredericks, who has had tremendous interest in mushrooms and fungus.
She leads
talks and has literally a mushroom club. And Cummingston came into its own because it doesn't have the wildflowers anymore, but apparently it's far better for fungus than Tenhave is. So she's doing a lot of stuff there. So next year we're going to start really working on bringing the trails back up to par in that park.
Well, I don't know a lot about mushrooms, but I know I've seen morel mushrooms growing in Royal Oak.
Really? Where?
Up against my girlfriend's garage.
Tell
me. A ton of them.
After the show. We don't want to announce
that on the show. I still am too afraid. I know what a morel mushroom looks like, but I'd still be afraid to pick it and eat it on my own.
But there is some weird fungus growing around lately, like right off your front lawn and in the trees. It's like, what is that?
Like the red and the white?
Yeah.
That comes from mulch. I think dirty mulch.
Well, we had a tree we cut down in our backyard, and where that stump was, it's constant mushrooms.
Well, they're basically eating the tree stump.
Well, we had it dug out, or we didn't have it dug out.
They ground it down about this far. There was a whole lot more in the ground.
Is it eventually going to stop?
Well, it might take 10 years.
Okay. You know, we got about 5 minutes.
In fact, I've always been one of those people that wouldn't pay to grind a stump because I know that if I just wait 10 or 20 years, it'll go away.
I know, but it was right in the middle of the yard.
Yeah. Of course, I like them high. Then you can put, things on them.
Yeah, you can
put
a table
leave a real
there.
Stump, not cut flush with the ground. It's like, well, leave the stump. It looks sort of neat.
It gets in the way of the lawnmower, though.
Well, tell us about your research for the Rouge River.
Well, one of the things I became interested in high school, actually, was I'd had an aquarium. And all of a sudden in the high school library, I discovered a book that showed all of the small fish that live in Michigan. And I thought, wow, this is sort of neat. And, of course, it's a lot more fun to go catch something than it is to go buy it out of a glass box in a store. So I'm bringing things home. And literally never stopped sort of studying what most people would call bait. You know, they're not big enough to catch and they're not game fish.
And you can't eat them.
You can. But, you eat a lot of them, yeah. Around the world, most people eat the little stuff than the big stuff.
They
get a big net and make a stew, that kind of thing. But I went back to college just a few years back. I was going to U of M Dearborn, and I had to have an internship. And again, I mentioned earlier to you, I went into the office and I said, why do I have to have an internship? And they said, looking at me with a straight face, so you know what it's like to work for a living. Yeah. And so I looked back at them and I said, I know I look 18, but didn't the hair color give it away, And they didn't even see humor in that. So I had to have, not only an internship, but you had to pay for the credit hours.
Wow.
Yeah. So I walked into Friends of the Rouge, which is on campus, and I said, look, I'm an expert on non-game native fish. Could you use fish community research in the Rouge River? And they jumped at it. So in my internship, I was like teaching people how to do it, which was probably a little different, but...
Well, you probably had a lot of fun doing that.
Oh, yeah. And then actually they got a grant, and for the last 3 years we were paid to... really bad pay by my standards, but paid to jump in the water and catch stuff, which was pretty good.
Do you have a fish tank at home?
There's 30 tanks in my basement.
Oh!
Yeah, and one of them has tropicals, and all the rest of them have native stuff, because I'm also... we're trying to work on a couple books. And so I've been working on getting photographs of all the fish we need for the last few years. So some stuff comes home just so I can get photos.
Do you have to keep them separated? Like, will some of them attack each other, different species?
Yeah, yeah. I do have a small fish called a grass pickerel at home right now. It's if you're familiar with northern pike, which get big and people go fishing for them, grass pickerel look just like northern pike, but that's as big as they get.
Oh, that's good size.
So if you're a really little fish, they're a terrible predator. I mean, he won't eat anything but fish, so unfortunately there's a whole lot of little guppies that have gone into feeding this guy. So,
do you catch your own guppies, or do you
to go buy the guppies to feed this guy, and his fins were a little ragged, so I couldn't get a good photograph of him, because I'd find somebody else I know that keeps aquariums that would like to keep this guy. I don't want a tank tied up, nor be buying guppies for years until he dies of old age. And
that's really neat, though. I'd like to... Do you have pictures of your fish tanks? Because it's cool. Like,
yeah,
all the
I have
native
a lot of
Michigan
photos of the fish and things.
That's really neat.
For the book.
We're working for the book, so you got to get good quality photos.
Yeah.
And
smile.
Yeah.
Stop moving your fish.
Yeah, and they don't stop moving on command.
No.
It's like, it's probably easier to take a photo of your dog. It might sit.
Yes,
the fish, it's like you can yell at it all you want. It's still going to be splashing around in there. So it takes a little bit of work.
Wow, that's really cool. What about owls? Not to change the subject. Mm. Do you have owl walks?
Yes, we do. We have owl hoots, they're called. There'll be one in hoot hoot, which none of the owls we have go hoot hoot, by the way. But we have one in December, January, February, and March. And we flip between the two parks, so we're not bothering them too much. But great horned owls by January will be sitting on eggs.
Wow.
Yeah, and what happens is mom and dad owls set up a territory big enough to have enough mice to feed them and the kids. If another owl moves in, your kids are going to starve.
Oh.
Because if both of you are trying to nest there, you can't do it. So if you go out with a tape recording of an owl call, it's liable to answer you back because all of a sudden it's like, who the heck is in my neighborhood? You know, this is my area. And sometimes they'll even fly in. So we've had them fly in and, you know, screech owls especially, and land in a tree maybe 6 feet over your head right next to the people. Because the owl doesn't care less about us. He's looking around for the other owl still. He's like, somebody
was here. That's one thing
here.
I've never seen is an owl in Royal Oak.
We had one land in our yard, and it was a small owl, and it let us get really close, and we were taking pictures. And it, I don't know, it was not shy. It wasn't afraid.
Yeah. Oh, no, they're not. Cause,
well, that
again,
was during the day. Don't they come out
at night?
It
was dusk.
Yeah,
it
being
dusk.
Out at in the dark, they're just not interacting with people or afraid of us.
Now, are you guaranteed to see an owl?
No, no.
Okay.
There's been
spring
pictures. Like whale watching.
I think last year we didn't see a single owl on four owl hoots, and we did have them answer back on a couple, so you could at least hear that.
Oh, from and, far away? Were they far?
Yeah, well, a little screech owl probably is only 100 yards from you at the most, a big great horned mite. But the year before we had owls fly in on every walk, so it's still pop.
How can you recognize where an owl is living?
They like hollow trees. Some of them nest in the top of broken off large trees. It's hard to see that. A lot of the, and I haven't seen this before, but a lot of times great horned owls, because they're taking a dump at their nest, they'll whitewash the tree. So sometimes you could see a tree with a lot of white bird droppings on it. And
that's where they live?
There's the owl nest up above.
Wow.
But I actually, and I've known people that have found them that way, I personally haven't. But the owl hoots are in the dark, and you know, if you Google Royal Oak Nature Society, you'd find schedules for our walks.
Yeah, what is your website?
I don't remember.
Well,
Google
it's on
Royal
this...
It's on the city's website,
yes. Yeah.
Or just Royal Oak Nature Society, like on Google, and bang, it pops up. But they're all free. There's no registering for them. It just show up. We did have once 99 people show up for an owl hoot. We didn't see an owl on that one.
Did they want their money back?
No, they're free, so, you know, yes, we'll double your money back, right?
Yeah. So you go out in the dark. Do you have flashlights?
I carry one that's about 1,000,000 candle watt power that I can light that owl up like it's daylight.
Oh.
But I prefer the other people not to. But you know what? It's never dark in the city, even in the woods.
Right.
There's no way you're walking into a tree.
No.
There's the sky. You know, you don't see the stars. The sky isn't black. The same thing. But you get some people that just seem to be locked into
the cell phones. Got
to have the flashlight or something.
All right, well, we got to go. We want to thank Bob Muller from Royal Oak Nature Society. And we want to mention Maggie McCabe's playing at The Coach on December 19th if you want to check her out. So thanks for watching the Chatty Patty.
Paula Walla.
Talk Talk Show.
Hello. So much to you, like going to a restaurant or hanging at the zoo, clothes and sports and funny news, crafts and travel too, nothing ever scripted, so expect the unexpected.
Hello, hello, hello.